वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला फिलॉसफी। आई एम सच्चिदानंद मिश्र, प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिलॉसफी एंड रिलीजन, बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी वाराणसी। एंड द मॉड्यूल आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस हियर, नव्य न्याय डिफिनेशन ऑफ पक्षता, पेपर लॉजिक 2। सो इन दिस मॉड्यूल लेट अस बिगिन विद द इंट्रोडक्शन। व्हाट इज नीडेड, व्हाई डू वी नीड टू नो पक्षता, व्हाट इज द necessity of knowing pakshata in order to have an inferential process. So actually what happens, there are certain cases, certain cognitive events are there which are planned and certain cognitive events are there which are not planned. So in both these cases, perceptual, scientific, verbal and inferential domain, there are these two kinds of cognitive events. When we infer the presence of clouds in the sky, when we are sitting in the room and listen to the thunder, and we infer that there are clouds in the sky, and this episode, this cognitive event, cognitive episode is not planned and it was not expected at all. But there is a case when we are searching for fire and we are in search of fire and think where there I can find out fire, and see smoke coming out of mountain and go and infer that there is a fire in the mountain because there is a smoke. So these two are cases. And one case more is possible, that suppose, because according to Nayayikas, one single thing can be known through inference, through verbal testimony and through perception also. So if something is known through verbal testimony, we can infer that. Through inference we can know. So here this is also a case of a planned event. So Gangesh, while discussing Pakshata in this section, tries to accommodate all these views, and therefore he is forming the definition of Pakshata, taking into consideration all these episodes, planned episodes of cognitive events and unplanned ones also. So in this inferential domain, he uses a technique known as qualified negation, and this is to be understood as vishishtabhav, the absence of a qualified. So the absence of qualified, if we take, then we can understand the nature of pakshata, and according to that Gangesha has defined pakshata. So actually there are two necessities in order to have inference. So while inferring, we need one thing that is known as vyapti gyan. Second thing we know, that is pakshadharmata gyan. So vyapti, we have discussed what is the nature of vyapti in earlier modules. We have discussed it very clearly, that what is the nature of vyapti. So what is the nature of pakshadharmata gyan? What is the nature of pakshadharmata? This is desired now. So pakshadharmata is defined saying that presence of hetu in paksha is called pakshadharmata. But presence of hetu in paksha, locatedness of hetu in paksha, if we say that this is the nature of pakshadharmata, then another question pops up, that is, what is the nature of paksha? So the nature of paksha is explained here in this discussion, and in this module you will be acquainted with this idea, that what are the tools and what is the nature of paksha where we are inferring. So what are the conceptual tools necessary for understanding the notion of pakshata, because this is a very peculiar concept and very technical one in Navya Nyaya. So the understanding of some of concepts would be very necessary. The first thing, that what is the nature of cognition in Navya Nyaya, this must be understood. And the term gyan, we have the term gyan in Sanskrit to denote cognition, and it is used in Navya Nyaya only in the episodic sense, this must be remembered, and it is never used in a dispositional sense. It is used, it covers many things like sensing, perception, memory, introspection, assumption, doubt, belief, and hypothetical cognition, that is what is known as tark. So all these are included in this gyan. So, and another point to understand this concept is that it is non-eternal and momentary. It is non-eternal, and not only non-eternal, but it is also momentary in individual selves. There is one kind of eternal cognition which is present in God that we are not going to deal with here, because we are only interested here. This is only related to these cognitive events which are produced in individual selves, individual life. So non-eternal cognition is actually considered to have generally that duration of three moments. And this duration of three moments should be understood in this way, that a cognition first generates, first produced, thereafter second moment it exists, and third moment it gets destructed. So these are three moments as generally a cognition can have. So this is the way of looking at cognition. Another point is here that threefold cognition of hetu, cognition of pakshadharmata, recollection of relation of pervasion, and the paramarsha. So there are three cognitions necessary to inferential cognition take place. If these three things are there, and it would be improper to say that these three are present together, because if paramarsha is produced, then one can have inferential cognition. There is no need of these two cognitions earlier, which were discussed earlier, cognition of pakshadharmata and the recollection of the relation of pervasion. But one point must be understood here, that if paramarsha is there and pakshata is there, so the inferential cognition would be produced, would take place. So these are two things necessary for this inferential cognition take place. Another point is very necessary, because we are going to discuss here Vishishta Bhava. So it would be very necessary to know the concept of Visheshan. So there are two kinds of qualifiers. In Sanskrit, we have two terms, and actually it is a difficulty to explain this concept in English, because I think there is no such kind of word which is available in Sanskrit. So there is no word in English. So there are two words, one is Visheshan and another is Upalakshan. So Visheshan is essential and Upalakshan is non-essential. So the term is explained by philosophers. Visheshan is something which is vidyamanatve sati itara vyavartakatva. This is to say, which is distinguishing something being present there, that will be Visheshan, and which is distinguishing something without being present, that will be Upalakshan. So taking examples, we can understand these ideas. Suppose we have to say that white cow. So white cow, only in that case you will utter when actually the cow is white. So white color distinguishes that cow from all other cows, and it is being present, being existent in that cow, it is distinguishing that cow from others. So this white color would be qualifier and Visheshan, it will be Visheshan. And take the example of Upalakshan, and this is a very famous example. Suppose one is moving in a village and ask for the house of Devadatta, and the person replies that, see, where there is a a crow sitting, that house is of Devadatta. And when he is moving, the crow has flown away from that house. In that case, the crow is not present there, but being absent also, the crow is making that house distinct from others. So it is making distinguished, making that house distinguished from others. Therefore, this crow would become upalakshan here. So these are two kinds of qualifiers, visheshan and upalakshan. And if we understand the nature of visheshan, because here we are going to deal with vishishta bhava. So visheshan, visheshya, and absence of that qualified. So we are going to take this way to define pakshata. But first, this would be proper to understand what pakshadharma, pakshata is not. What pakshata is not, this will be the place to understand. Because there are many examples, many positions adopted by different various philosophers. Some would say that the doubt of sadhya is pakshata. So this is one position. This is to say, with the property, pakshata is many times equated with the property of doubtful probandum. This is to say, if probandum is not determined, if it is not decided, it is not proved there, and if it is doubtful, then you can say that is paksha. Where probandum is not proved, that and doubtful, that is paksha. It is one point, one way of looking at it. So, but here Ganges says that doubt cannot function as an essential qualifier, visheshan, because after the perception of the province and the remembrance of pervision, doubt will vanish just before the occurrence of immediate sufficient cause of the inferential cognition. The point Ganges is trying to raise is that in inferential process, paramarsh has to be there in order to produce inferential cognition. So another thing is that the doubt should be there, because you are saying that doubt is pakshata. So doubt can be pakshata in two ways. One way is either it is a qualifier, or it is either it is visheshan or it is upalakshan. It is essential or it is non-essential. So it is not essential at all, because there is a case when doubt arises and you remember vyapti pervision, universal concomitance, and thereafter there is a production of paramarsh. So the rule, if you remember, I explained just now that according to Nayayikas, a cognition could be present only one moment it is produced, it is generated, and another moment it stays, and third moment it is destroyed. So suppose there is a doubt, and thereafter you perceive the smoke, thereafter you remember pervision. So there are three moments, and when paramarsh is produced, till then this doubt would vanish, it will not be there. Therefore, it cannot be visheshan, because in order to become visheshan, it is the necessity that it must be present there when there is a paramarsh. But this is not the case, it is not present in that situation, therefore it cannot be visheshan at all. Secondly, if you say whether this doubt can be upalakshan, no, it cannot be upalakshan either. The point is that because in that case it would not function as a distinguishing mark between proved cases and unproved cases. The point is that this upalakshan, being upalakshan, it cannot function as a distinguishing mark between proved cases and unproved cases, as crow can function the distinguishing mark in case of one is searching for Devadatta's home. So this is not the case here. So this doubt cannot be upalakshan. Another point is that because there are certain some other philosophers who proposed some other points, so prakshata cannot also be equated with the negation of the conjunction of the certainty of the existence of sadhya and the certainty of the non-existence of sadhya. For negation of conjunction is justified even if one of them is present. Actually, this position is taken as sadhak badhak pramana bhava. Sadhak badhak pramana bhava is formulated in this form, and this is said that there shouldn't be sadhak pramana and there shouldn't be badhak pramana. This is to say there should not be existence of sadhya, and there should not be certainty of the existence of sadhya, and there should not be certainty of the non-existence of sadhya, and both are taken together. So here it is said that for negation of conjunction is justified even if one of them is present. So the point is here, Gangesh is taking very clever attitude. Suppose there is a pot on the table and one asks you whether there are two things, pot and cloth. You can very well say no, there are not two things, only pot is there, cloth is not there. In that case also we say that pot and cloth are not there. So in the same way, if you are saying that there should not be certainty of existence of sadhya and certainty of the absence of both, if you are taking here, so in that case if one is present, in that case also this absence will be there, but both these, if one is present, then the inferential cognition doesn't take place. Therefore this would not be the case where inferential cognition takes place. So this cannot be the nature of pakshata. This pakshata cannot be equated with it. There is another point, it cannot also be defined in terms of the conjunction of the separate negation of both. So this is to say both should be there, both absences should be there. Not here, it is not said that absence of both. Here first it was said that absence of both should be there and it cannot be equated, and if I say that both absences should be there, so this is a different thing. So it cannot, here it is negated that this is not also the case, that this cannot be pakshata, because in that case, in this second conjunct, the absence of the certainty of the non-existence of the sadhya would be redundant. So actually here Gangesh is saying that why you are expecting that there should be certainty of the non-existence of sadhya. There should be the absence of the certainty of the non-existence of sadhya. It should be given up. It is not needed at all in that case. Only one part would be sufficient enough to say. So why shouldn't we take only that part? This is to say, if I say that siddha bhava pakshata. So here it is said that it is also not the case. We cannot accept this is pakshata. Pakshata is not just the absence of the certainty of the probability of the sadhya. Certainty of the existence of sadhya, this is to say clearly. So if it is not the case that sadhya is not proved, then you can infer at the place. This is the point, that if at a particular place A or B or anything else sadhya is not proved, then you can prove it, that A, B, C, etc. would be paksh in that situation. But Gangesh is saying that it is not also true. It is not. It cannot be accepted as pakshata. The point is that in that case, pakshata is also not the haver of sadhya dharma. The point is that this would not be covered in that case. If there is a desire to infer, that case would not be covered. Suppose Nayayika say that if there is certainty of sadhya, Suppose you are told that there is a fire in the mountain. But you are told that there is a fire in the mountain. You are sure that there is fire in the mountain. But if you see smoke coming out of the mountain, you can infer, you are willing, okay, I would like to prove it that there is a fire in the mountain. So you can infer taking the smoke as provence, and you can prove the provendum fire in the mountain. So this will be the case. But here in this case, there will not be pakshata at all. There would not be pakshata at all in mountain, because there is not absence of the certainty of existence of sadhya, because it is proved already through verbal testimony that there is a fire in the mountain. Another point. So pakshata is also not the haver of sadhya dharma that one desires to have by inferential cognition. And this is the point that, okay, you are giving importance to the desire. So why don't you take that if there is any desire, if you want to prove something somewhere, then that somewhere would be paksha. So suppose you are willing to prove A in A, Y, then Y will be paksha. So Gangesh says that this is not the case. You cannot define in that way, because there are certain cases where there is no desire to prove, but there inferential cognition takes place. You are sitting in a room, ghana garjatena megha anumanat. You are sitting in your house, you are not seeing what is there outside. You are not willing to, you don't have any kind of desire to prove that there are clouds in the sky. But in that case also, if you listen the thunder, then this inference takes place that there are clouds in the sky. So this is this would not be covered by this definition of pakshata. Therefore, all these definitions which were proposed by other philosophers are not to be accepted. And Gangesh says that we cannot accept all these, any one of these definitions. Therefore, he makes an attempt to form another definition. And what he does. Formating, adding two alternatives by Vishishta Bhava. So that is the technique of Pakshadharmata. So what this we can understand at this moment, that what is the final definition of Pakshata. So it is said that by Gangesh Upadhyaya that Sisadhaisha Viraha Vishishta Sadhaka Pramana Bhavaha Pakshata. So the point is that pakshata is the absence of probability qualified by the absence of the desire to have inferential cognition. In other terms, it would be proper to say that pakshata is the absence of certainty of the existence of probendum qualified, and where that certainty, that siddhi, that cognition is qualified by the absence of desire to have inferential cognition. So this is to say, there probability, that is siddhi. Probability means siddhi. The meaning of siddhi is that you determinate cognition, where cognition in which it is proved that there is siddhi, there is a fire, there is a probendum. So when probendum is proved in this cognition, that cognition should be not there, but the absence of that cognition is required. But the absence of that cognition would not be sufficient enough to explain the nature of pakshata. But that cognition must be qualified by the absence of desire to have inferential cognition. So pakshata is found in the following cases. Where there is a desire to have inferential cognition, though you are certain that there is a siddhi, and also if there is not siddhi, and where there is absence of both, in those cases also pakshata is available. This pakshata will be available. Only one case is there when pakshata will not be available. If there is probability, this is to say you have a cognition of existence of probandum and you don't have desire. So in that case there will not be pakshata. In that case inferential cognition would not take place. So here let us understand vishishta bhava, because without understanding vishishta bhava we cannot understand the concept of pakshata. So to make the notion of vishishta bhava explicit clear, let us take the example absence of blue pot. So when we can say that there is no blue pot at all, so here there are two things, and one is blue and another is pot. So suppose there is a pot but not blue, then there will be absence of blue pot. If there is blue and not pot, then also there will be the case that you can say that there is absence of blue pot. Suppose there is not blue, there is no pot, in that case also there will be absence of blue pot. And there will be one position when there is blue and also pot, then only you can say that you cannot say that there is no blue pot. So this is vishishta bhava. Vishishta bhava is coming here. These three cases are there where vishishta bhava is. One is when blue is not there, and second is when pot is not there, third is when blue is not there and pot is not there. So in that case you can say that there is a vishishta bhava. It is a very similar concept, parallel to the stroke function technique of symbolic logic in modern Western philosophy and Western logic. So to understand this technique clearly, we can take this symbolic representation of pakshata. We can describe the definition of pakshata symbolically as follows in that way. Suppose Tx is equal to x, that is thesis. Tx means paksha, that is thesis, paksha. Dx means desired to be proved. So D means desire to be proved. So Dx is equal to x is desire to be proved. And Px is equal to x is proved. Then to say that x is a thesis is definitionally equivalent to saying that it is not the case that x is not desired to be proved and that x is proved. So this is the point, that x is not, this is not the case that x is not desired to be proved and that x is proved. So here in that way it is a possibility that x is not desired to be proved. In that case also inferential cognition could take place, and if there is a desire, in that case also inferential process would take place. Given the fact that if there is certainty, there is a cognition, there is a certainty of probandum, then you have a desire. And if there is no certainty of probandum, you don't have desire. Without desire, the inferential process could take place. So thus, this is that is by definition, Tx is equivalent to negation of boxed negation dx and px, and by applying de Morgan's law and double negation we get Tx is equivalent to negation of dx and negation of px. So here these two are taken in that way differently, and by applying double negation we can also say that Tx is equivalent to dx and tx. And here the disjunction is inclusive disjunction. This is to say that is the point that by definition x is paksha if and only if either x is desired to be proved or x is not yet proved. in both these cases it will be paksha or both. That is to say, x is not proved and is desired to be proved. So if it is not proved and there is a desire to be proved, then inferential process would take place. And if it is proved and there is a desire to be proved, then the inferential process would take place. And if it is desired to be proved and it is proved, then the inferential process would take place. So these are situations, three situations in which inferential process would take place, because these are three situations when there is pakshata. And fourth situation would be that there is no desire to prove, but it is proved. There is no desire to be proved and to be proved and it is proved. So there is siddhi and no sishadesha at all. So in Sanskrit it is called desire to be proved is sishadesha and siddhi is proved. So if it is proved, this that means there is siddhi, and there is not desire to be proved, then this inferential process would not take place. And if this is the case, that it is proved and there is desire to be proved, then inferential process would take place. And if it is not proved and there is a desire to be proved, then there is no problem at all, there inferential process would take place. And if there is no desire to be proved and it is not proved, in that case also the inferential process will take place. As in case of inference of clouds in the sky, you are sitting in room and you are not seeing what is happening outside, you are not willing to infer that there is a fire, there are clouds in the sky, but you can infer it because it is not proved and you don't have desire to prove, but there is a mechanically this process take place. You listen to the thunder and you remember that thunder can be there only if there are clouds, and you remember that is, you remember the pervision, you remember vyapti, and thereafter there is a paramarsha and there is a conclusion that there are clouds in the sky. So this is happening here in this case. So some points here to understand that sishadhisha and paramarsha and probability have to exist simultaneously in a single self. But the ontological structure, because this to justify this explanation or definition of pakshata, this is the necessity that there is a possibility that sishadhisha and paramarsha and the probability that is siddhi must exist together. But as I have explained, according to Nyaya, there is this possibility is a little bit confusing. Whether it is possible, we can doubt. The point is that we told you that if there is all cognitions are momentary, it means they are produced at one moment, they exist second moment, and they are destroyed at third moment. So these are three things, and all these, this criteria, this rule is not applicable only to cognition, but it is applicable to desire also. So because desire is also a special quality of the self, a special quality of individuals, so it is applicable to that also. So sishadhisha, suppose sishadhisha is produced and thereafter paramarsha is produced and thereafter siddhi is produced, so you cannot say that there is a need of pakshata, because in this case this desire would vanish next moment, in this moment when siddhi is getting produced. And if you change the way whatever we should be there, these three would not exist at the same time. This is a great difficulty felt by Nayayikas. And to solve this difficulty, they have said that there is another possibility, that the Paramarsh is in the form of Siddhi. This is to say, Paramarsh is such kind of, when it not only includes Paramarsh, but also includes Siddhi. So in that case, only two are there, because at the same time, two cognitions are not produced, but only one cognition is produced, and that cognition, the object of that cognition are two. One is Siddhi, and another is Vyapti Vishishta Paksha Dharmata. So if Vyapti Vishishta Paksha Dharmata is content of that cognition, and also Siddhi is a determination of presence of Saddhi in Paksha, is also the content of that cognition, then it is a Siddhyatmak Paramarsh. This is a Paramarsh in the form of Siddhi. So there will be Siddhi, and if we don't accept this kind of Pakshata, in that case there won't be inferential cognition. Inferential cognition would not take place. Therefore, we need to formulate in this way the process of inference. So we can understand, and Nayayikas have tried to explain this concept, that Siddhi is preventer and Sishadhisa is stimulant for having inferential cognition. That is why where Siddhi is present, it is not possible to have inferential cognition in the absence of Sishadhisa. Okay, a desire to have inference. So this is another example is given many times in Nyaya text, that one example is given, that there is moonstone and sunstone, and this is said that actually if there is a fire and moonstone is present at the place, the fire would not burn. But if you put sunstone and moonstone together with fire, then the fire will burn. And if you take away a moonstone, there will be the fire will burn. So here also you can have that there are four possibilities. If both are there, if sunstone is there and moonstone is there, then there will be burning, fire will burn. And if there is only sunstone and fire, then the fire will burn. And if there is no sunstone, neither moonstone, then also fire will burn. And if sunstone is there and fire is there, it will burn. But suppose there is this situation, that moonstone is there and fire is there, but there is no sunstone, in that case fire will not burn. So you can say that absence of sunstone is qualifier of, it is actually it is uttejak, it is a uttejak, therefore because it is stimulant, so it is stimulator. So preventer is moonstone, but only moonstone is not preventer, but moonstone qualified by the absence of sunstone is the preventer. Therefore here the absence of sunstone becomes delimiter or bounder of this pratibandhakata which is present in moonstone. So in this case, this is the very similar case to this pakshata, and in case of pakshata, this is also the case. You can understand that here sisa, the absence of sisadhisha, because sisadhisha is the desire to prove, is stimulant, therefore the absence of sisadhisha is taken as delimiter of siddhi, delimiter of that obstacle, that is siddhi probability. If the absence is there, then there will be pakshata, and if the absence is not there, there won't be pakshata. So this is the definition of pakshata. So to sum up all these issues, we can understand that two cognitions are required basically to produce inferential cognition. One is Vyapti Gyan and second is Pakshadharmata. पक्षधर्मता ज्ञान एंड पक्षधर्मता इज पक्षधर्मता ज्ञान इज प्रेजेंस ऑफ हेतु इन पक्ष दैट इज दैट शुड बी कॉग्नाइज्ड एंड व्याप्ति शुड बी रिमेंबर्ड एंड आफ्टर दैट परामर्श टेक्स प्लेस एंड इन एडिशन टू द नेचर ऑफ व्हाट इज द लोकस वेयर वी कैन इन्फर समथिंग सो पक्षता इज रिक्वायर्ड वी कैन नॉट इन्फर एनी वेयर ओनली सर्टन प्लेसेस वी कैन इन्फर सो व्हाट आर द सर्टन प्लेसेस वेयर वी कैन इन्फर दैट इज द पॉइंट डिस्कस्ड हियर इन दिस मॉड्यूल इन पक्षता एंड इफ यू आर विलिंग टू अंडरस्टैंड समथिंग मोर डू टर्न टू द लर्न मोर सेक्शन एंड यू मे कंसल्ट द ई टेक्स्ट विच इज अवेलेबल देयर